Hi, I'm Brianna.
I'm Andrew.
I'm Kyle.
I'm Lucas.
And we're Team America. Fuck yeah!
On Friday, March 11th, 2010, a magnitude 9 earthquake hit off the east coast of Japan and resulted in a tsunami which crippled the area and its entire infrastructure. The nuclear plant at Fukushima was not designed to handle a tsunami of this magnitude, and after the tsunami wave went over the protecting walls, it flooded the plant and many of the electronics were wet and damaged or destroyed. The lack of properly functioning equipment led to fears of a meltdown, and after trapped gas continued to cause explosions in the plant and further damaged the reactors, the levels of radioactive materials escaping rose. This leak of radioactive materials that rapidly spread to the surrounding areas quickly dispersed itself into the local water supply, mostly in the form of iodine-131 and cesium-137. To combat the radiation in the drinking water, the government immediately put into action a plan that was based on importing drinking water in clean bottles. A more long-term solution must be created and implemented. Our plan is to create a modified water treatment facility that removes radiation from the water using reverse osmosis, along with a few other pretreatment methods.
Reverse osmosis is a filtration system that removes molecules from solutions by applying pressure to the solution when it is on one side of a selective membrane. In our case, reverse osmosis is being used to remove iodine-131 from water. Our design uses a thin film membrane with a particle size of 0.1 to 1 nanometers. The diameter of iodine-131 is 0.14 nanometers, so the thin film membrane will effectively remove most iodine-131. As the top picture shows, multiple reverse osmosis units can be used to achieve the desired effluent concentrations. The bottom picture shows the semi-permeable layering system used in reverse osmosis. The membrane is highly permeable to water, but essentially impermeable to iodine-131. So pure water crosses the membrane, and iodine-131 remains in the filter, which will need to be removed as hazardous waste.
Water entering a reverse osmosis treatment system must be carefully monitored prior to filtering through the membrane. This is mainly due to the fact of the spiral womb design and extremely small pores of the semi-permeable membrane surface. Membrane fouling describes the buildup of constituents in the feed stream on the surface. These are the necessary steps to ensure quality water will enter a reverse osmosis treatment system. Here's an overview of the process. First off, we want to screen the solids, which we have already learned in class. As water enters a reservoir, a coagulant is added, and then is set into a flocculation tank, and then dumps into a sludge collector. We propose to use cartridge filtration. This is described as a string of polypropylene wound membranes that can take out particles 1 to 6 micrometers in size. We will then add chlorination to kill bacteria and microorganisms. This is safe for the drinking water, but also the chlorine will clog the membrane with slime. This then moves into our first round of dosing. We will put in metabisulfate to deactivate the chlorine. Our second round of dosing will include antiscalants, which prevents scalings on the membrane surface, which will clog it. We then have to adjust the pH between 4.5 to 6.5, which is the optimal range for reverse osmosis. We then have to take out all the dissolved gases, which would yield inconsistent results. Then we are ready to reverse osmosis.
Calculations for sizing the reverse osmosis system. The first step in determining the required size of our reverse osmosis system is to find the concentration of iodine-131 in the drinking water in Japan needing to be removed. On March 20th in Fukushima, Japan, the iodine-131 level was recorded as 308 becquerels per liter of water, and from this number we determined the concentration of iodine-131 in the water from the equation seen. This concentration was the influent concentration for the system, and the effluent concentration was set as the legal limit for infants in Japan of 100 becquerels per liter of water. Both the influent and effluent concentrations are shown on the slide in grams per liter. We assumed that each person used 374 liters of water per day, and creating a facility which meets the needs of 400,000 Japanese residents requires a flow rate of 149,600 meters cubed per day, or approximately 1.7 meters cubed per second. To complete our analysis, we needed to calculate the feed flow rate, the permeate flow rate, and the concentrate flow rate. which are derived from the equations shown above, and all are calculated in meters cubed per second, as shown on the slide. The next step in determining the sizing of our reverse osmosis system is to calculate the concentration gradient based on the influent and effluent concentrations. We have assumed that 5% of the iodine-131 has been removed by coagulation and flocculation, and we have determined the concentration gradient from the equation shown. The membrane surface area needed for the reverse osmosis system is directly determined from the required flow rate and concentration gradient. The equation above was used to calculate the surface area of the membranes needed to treat our system in meters squared. Using an example reverse osmosis filter, we can determine the number of filters needed for our specific treatment facility. The typical filter of the size shown on the slide contains 41 meters squared of membrane surface area, and in our facility would require just under 60,000 filters to treat the water adequately. The final step in sizing our reverse osmosis process is to determine the net operating pressure at which the system will operate. The net operating pressure is defined as the difference between the imposed pressure gradient and the osmotic pressure gradient. This is the key component which drives reverse osmosis and allows there to be flow from the more concentrated region to the less concentrated region. The net operating pressure was calculated in the equation shown and was found to be 70.62 kilopascals.